In this video, we're going to talk about the inheritance patterns of certain human traits and genetic disorders.
So, do human traits follow the same inheritance patterns that Gregor Mendel saw in the pea plants? The answer is, for the most part, yes. Gregor Mendel's principles apply to the inheritance. Of many human traits. In fact, several of these traits just show the simple dominance relationship that Gregor Mendel saw. For example, freckles is dominant to no freckles. Having a widow's peak is dominant to having a straight hairline. Having free earlobes is dominant to having attached earlobes. In all of these cases, these traits are controlled by a single gene, and there are two common alleles, one dominant and one recessive. So many human traits show these simple inheritance patterns. These traits are controlled by genes on the autosomes. Remember, the autosomes in humans are the 22 pairs of non-sex chromosomes. Most human genetic disorders are recessive, meaning that it takes two copies of the recessive allele in order to show the trait. And individuals can be carriers of these diseases. Now, a carrier of a recessive disorder will have one of the disease alleles, but they will not show the trait. The carrier is always heterozygous. Likely, the carrier has no idea that they actually are a carrier for this particular trait because they do not show any of the symptoms. Now, unlike being a carrier for a contagious disease, genetic diseases are not contagious. Meaning, if someone is a carrier for a genetic disorder, they don't have any risk of passing it on to anyone except for their direct offspring. With genetic diseases, a carrier could possibly pass a disease allele to the next generation. Since it is a recessive disorder, it's only concerning if both parents are carriers for the same disease. Here we see an example of a genetic disease where capital D is the allele for normal hearing, and the little d allele is for a genetic form of deafness. Now, in this case, both parents are heterozygous for this particular gene, meaning both parents have normal hearing, but they are a carrier for this recessive deafness allele. Now, when we look at the Punnett square of this cross, we see that there's a possibility for their offspring to be homozygous dominant, possibility for their offspring to be carriers, just like the parents, and also a possibility for their offspring to be deaf. Keep in mind, this Punnett square is not saying that this couple has exactly four children. It's also not saying that the first child will always be homozygous dominant. What this Punnett square is telling us is that each time this couple has a child, there's an equal probability of that child landing in any one of these four squares. And so, looking at the probability of the child being deaf, we see that there's a 1 in 4 chance, or a 25% chance. Now, some human genetic disorders are dominant. Remember, just because an allele is dominant doesn't mean that it's common. Dominant genetic disorders typically are very rare in the population. But what makes it a dominant disorder is that an individual needs only one copy of the disease allele in order to have that genetic disorder. So, achondroplasia is an example of a dominant disorder. It is a form of dwarfism. Polydactylism. Is having extra fingers or toes on your hands and feet. And it is another example of a dominant genetic disorder. Now, both of these disorders are caused by a dominant allele, yet they tend to be very rare in the general population. So again, emphasizing, just because an allele is dominant doesn't mean that it's common. Now, for dominant genetic disorders, it is impossible to be a carrier for that genetic disorder, because as long as someone has one of the disease-causing alleles, they will end up showing the trait. Here's a photo of a surgeon who has achondroplasia. Now, this particular surgeon, he dedicated his medical career to helping others with his genetic disease. He performs therapeutic surgeries for them. Now, achondroplasia is not a disease that can be cured through surgery. However, there are secondary side effects and complications which can be limited or helped with therapeutic surgeries. Now, what about dominant disorders which are lethal, which are fatal? Now, if a dominant disorder is lethal, and it's expressed early in life, that organism is not likely to survive to pass it on to that next generation. They won't have survived long enough to reproduce. Only if a disorder is expressed late in life, and in this case, again, referring to lethal dominant disorders, only if that disorder is expressed late in life will that individual survive to have offspring. Now, examples of lethal dominant disorders include Huntington's disease and certain forms of Alzheimer's. Now, what's tragic with these situations is that often individuals do not know they have these diseases, again, until later in life. And at that point, their children are often taking care of them. And the child now knows that they have a 50-50 chance of also having received this dominant lethal allele from their parent who is affected. This is the end of our discussion of inheritance patterns for human genetic disorders. In the next video, we're going to talk about pedigree analysis and also what happens when genetic disorders are found within the genes in the sex chromosomes. See you in the next video.